Good evening and welcome to First Presbyterian Church. Earlier this week, when I looked into the week ahead, I noticed that I was both leading the evening worship service and helping to lead on a middle school retreat. It's often the case that as pastors, when we see that we might have a conflict of interest, that we will exchange leading the worship service in the night and allow another one to do it for us. I thought to myself, well, I'll be home around 4:30. I won't be too tired. Wrong. This weekend, I laughed until I cried twice. I yelled until I realized it was of little value. I held my breath as I walked through our son's rooms, tiptoeing over an ungodly amount of articles of clothes that were laid out from one end of the room to the other. I'm so thankful for Johnson & Johnson and the invention of deodorant. But more than anything, I really did realize in a new way just the faithfulness of the Lord. To see the Lord working in ways that we can see and ways that we can't see in the lives of our covenant sons and daughters and their friends, it really was a refreshing but exhausting week that I had. And I just am so thankful, and I hope that you are too, of just our youth staff of Cam and Chandler and Frank and the work that they do, and Mary Clayton, she wasn't there this weekend, but with our middle school and high school students. And if you see them, I see Cam out there tonight, just thank them for the exhausting work of ministering to our middle school students. If you would, please, now open to you the evening service portion of our bulletin. And this catechism question actually dovetails nicely into the week ahead of this presidential and local elections. Some have said that the biblical theology provides a narrow but essential teachings to how we think through government. Narrow because the Bible and the full scope of things that it speaks into spends a very limited amount of time speaking directly into politics. But the essential beliefs that should govern our thinking and politics really come from the Bible, namely that all human beings have dignity, and the government's role, one of its primary roles, is to protect life at all seasons. Well, why is that true? Well, tonight's catechism question answers that. Question 10, if you would, please respond with the answer. How did God create man? God created man, male and female, in his own image and in knowledge, righteousness, and holiness to rule over the other creatures. Please stand for a call to worship. Call to worship is the same text I read to our middle school students this morning. Psalm 34:8, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. Please lift your hands with me if you would. Our Father, as we see so many activities taking place, even before the service tonight with Westminster Choir rehearsing, with hand-in-hand ministries having a leadership meeting tonight, and the just groups meeting, a women's Bible study, and so many other activities, Lord, we just thank you for the energy that's here on Sunday night. And Father, more than the energy that's here, Lord, we thank you and we realize that we are here because of you drawing us to yourselves and giving us a mission and a purpose. And Father, we thank you that for the joy it is that we not only can hear of you, but that we have tasted and we have seen your goodness. And Father, help us more and more to believe that those who are in this place of safety and refuge within you are in the best place to be. And if there is one in here tonight who believes that life is found apart from you, or who doesn't realize the joy it is to be found in you, that tonight would be the night of salvation. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Tonight we'll be receiving new members into our church, and part of the process of these new members joining the church is they'll meet with at least two elders just to explain their testimony, and it's an opportunity for them to ask any questions about this church as well. And after each of these meetings, we've done them for the past two weekends at 5 o'clock, I often know before the evening's out or early on Monday that I'm going to receive text or phone calls or an email from these men just saying, you won't believe the story that I heard tonight of this particular person and the way that the Lord has worked in their lives. And the elders will quickly tell you one of their favorite things to do is to have these meetings and just to hear about the Lord's faithfulness to people from all different parts of the world. And tonight we'll see just a small glimpse of that. And I say that to you just to encourage you that the stories that we often hear are the stories that we encourage you to hear around your kitchen tables. As you open your circles of life and pursue some of these new members to get to know them a bit more than just meeting them tonight. So we call their names out and they often face you because we want you to see their faces, and after the service make a point of introducing yourself to them. I will now call out the names by parish, and if you would please face the congregation, and after I call everyone I will ask you the five vows that we've been talking through up to this point. Joining us in the Brentwood Parish, and these first three will be baptized tonight as well. Yaru Yang and her husband, Kaimei Han. From the Evans Parish, Juliana Horst. Evans Parish as well, Ken and Lisa Lynch. Their two daughters, Isabella and Eliana. Grovetown Parish, Cole and Kelly Rabin. And in Lake Forest Parish, David and Angela Watkins. In the Masters Parish, Jenny Mao. Masters Parish as well, Hope McDonald. Mary Clayton and Will Murphy. Mary Clayton's on staff with us, the high school students. Masters Parish as well, Jinshu Pan and Pong Zong. Asher Allen. Cameron and Gina Anderson, better known as Cam. Cam's with the middle school students. Catherine Austin. Joy Brown. Kelly and Zach Cook. Eric Fullwider. Kyle Grinnell. Lexi Haskins. All these are Master Parish. Clay Norsworthy. Maggie Snyder, along with her brother Mitch Snyder, sitting next to each other. That's such a good sight. Carlisle and Kelsey Basin. Madison Vermilia. Heath Robinson. Pleasant Home Parish. River Parish, Brittany Hughes. River Parish, Barbara Leverett. She joins her husband David in membership. David, you come on forward if you would as well. Dave's a covenant child of the church. We've got a son and daughter, Luke and Hannah. Stevens Creek Parish, George Lively. also known as Aaron Kirchhoff's father. Westminster Parish, Morgan McClendon. And finally, Wheeler Parish, May Wallace Baker. Okay, if you all would face me. If you on the far end, if you want to make your way around so I can see you, come on down this way. Good, 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 good. I'll ask you these five questions of membership, and if you would, please, after each one of them, acknowledge I do. Do you acknowledge yourself to be sinners in the sight of God, justly deserving his displeasure, and without hope except in his sovereign mercy? Do you? Do you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ as the Son of God and Savior of sinners? And do you receive and rest upon him alone for salvation as is offered in the gospel? Do you? Do you now resolve and promise in humble reliance upon the grace of the Holy Spirit that you will endeavor to live as becomes the followers of Christ? Do you? Let's try again. Do you? Okay, all right. My fault. Told you I didn't sleep much. Do you promise to support the church in its worship and work to the best of your ability? Do you? Do you submit yourselves to the government and discipline of the church and promise to study its purity and peace? Do you? Let's pray. Father, we do thank you for these new members joining the church, and as you fit us together to reflect the complexion of heaven, and as you fit us together to be a body who lives on mission, to be a people who restore others and help to rebuild this city through the gospel and for the glory of your name, we thank you for these new families who will come alongside us that we might bless them as they bless our lives in kind. In your name we pray, amen. If all everyone except the three being baptized, you can now take a seat. I'll stay up here just for a moment. Those being baptized, if you come down to the font, please. And Julianne, perfect. Throughout the Bible, we are given signs of a promise through covenants. These covenants of grace are a reminder to us that God will redeem a people for himself. We see different ways that these covenants are administered, but they always point to one central truth, that I will claim and I will bring a people to myself. In the Old Testament, we see these covenants administered with the removal of skin. It reminds us of the need for removal of sin from our lives if we're going to be made in a right relationship with God. In the New Testament, we're seeing a new sign of that with the cleansing of water, with the truth that those who are in Christ, they are cleansed with the renewing spirit through which he gives us. Tonight, as we experience his baptism, each baptism, I think, represents and we see a different facet of God's grace. As we often baptize infants at this particular font, we're reminded of the truth that we come to Christ as helpless babes. And the only way that we're going to be made right with him, it's by him pursuing us. And tonight, it'll be adults who are being baptized. I think of Juliana, who comes from over an hour away to worship with us. A high school student whose life is filled with so many other things, but on her own initiative, she wants to be baptized in the family of Christ. And we pray that as we see that, we'll be reminded of God's faithfulness in her family, and she'll experience that love, that she has a heavenly Father who will love her all the days of her life. For the other couple who's with us tonight, Chimei Han and his wife, Yaru Young, they come to us from a bit further than an hour away, I believe. They come to us from China. And we're reminded when at Pentecost, we're told the truth that God is working not only in ways that we can see, but he's working in people's lives far beyond those that we're able to see. And what a beautiful picture it is for us to remember that God is working both here in Augusta and around the world. We pray for you tonight as you experience the water hitting your forehead. We pray that you would remind that no matter where your life goes, if it goes outside the boundaries of Augusta, that it will never, your lives will never go beyond the love and grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, if you would, please kneel before the font and I'll baptize you. Juliana Horst, daughter of the King, child of the covenant. I baptize you in the name of the Father, of the Son, of the Holy Spirit. Kamehan, son of the King, child of the covenant. I baptize you in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Yawu Yang, daughter of the King, child of the covenant. I baptize you in the name of the Father, of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Robert Campbell, if you'd please pray for these families.
Let's pray. Father, thank you for these three children of the covenant, for calling them to yourself, Father, for giving them eyes to see you and ears to hear you, and Father, for giving us the joy of their fellowship. Father, I pray that you would be with them all the days of their life. Father, they would not go anywhere without the assurance of you going with them. And Father, I pray that you would bless their families for generations to come. Father, I pray that you would bless their children, that you bless their children's children. Father, that you would bless their parents and that you would be with them wherever their families are tonight. Father, I pray that you would bring this body around them. Father, that the fellowship that we enjoy in you would be extended to them. And Father, that you would advance your kingdom through them and through our fellowship with them. We love you and we thank you for them. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
If the ushers will please come forward for tonight's offering. Pray, Father, we ask that you would give us eyes to see you at work, not only in our lives personally, but in our lives corporately. Father, as we see these students sing, we thank you for the relationship between First Pres and for Westminster Schools, and we do pray for these students that the truths that they're learning would land in fertile soil, and that as they begin to move towards college and beyond, that you would bless their lives, that they would see those being baptized, and they would be reminded of their own baptism and the truth of your love for them, and would it seal their consciences forever with the reality of you being preeminent in their lives. Father, thank you for the so many ministries that we're able to participate in, the so many families who you've allowed us to join armed in arm with as we raise our children and as we worship you. Thank you for the small picture we have tonight of you at work in our midst. We thank you now that we could give to you an offering that would advance these ministries and that would be used to build your kingdom. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
I will live my life.
Turn with me in your Bibles to the book of Luke. We've started this new series on Luke's gospel. We looked at verses 1 through 4 last week. Notice that Luke is writing to this one called Most Excellent. I appreciate those of you who have begun calling me Most Excellent, as I invited you to last week. And this Most Excellent Theophilus, this very important man apparently, and Luke is writing to him this thorough account of the life and work of Christ from before his birth until his ascension, and then into the book of Acts until the imprisonment of Paul. We focused on the reliability of the scriptures, its inerrancy, its infallibility, its reliable nature upon which we can build our lives. We can stake our lives on the promises of this book. And so now Luke begins to unfold the story. Unfolds the story of the revelation of Jesus Christ, beginning with this man named Zechariah and his wife Elizabeth, who would become the parents of John the Baptist, the one who would be the forerunner of Jesus Christ, the last Old Testament prophet. So we're seeing the closing of the gap between the Old Testament and the New Testament. There is no gap between the Old and New Testament. God continues on in his work of stitching together this one story about the one people of God saved through the one covenant of grace experienced in Jesus Christ, fulfilled in Christ. We take up the story then in verse 5 of Luke chapter 1 and read through verse 25. In the time of Herod, king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah who belonged to the priestly division of Abijah. His wife Elizabeth was also a descendant of Aaron. Both of them were upright in the sight of God, observing all the Lord's commandments and regulations blamelessly. But they had no children because Elizabeth was barren and they were both well along in years. Once when Zechariah's division was on duty and he was serving as priest before God, he was chosen by lot, according to the custom of the priesthood, to go into the temple of the Lord and burn incense. And when the time for the burning of incense came, all the assembled worshipers were praying outside. Then an angel of the Lord appeared to him standing at the right side of the altar of incense. And when Zechariah saw him, he was startled and was gripped with fear. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you're to give him the name John. He will be a joy and a delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He is never to take wine or other fermented drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even from birth. Many of the people of Israel will he bring back to the Lord their God, and he will go on before the Lord in the spirit of the power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the fathers to their children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous to make ready a people
prepared for the Lord. Zechariah asked the angel, "How can I be sure of this? I am an old man and my wife is well along in years." The angel answered, "I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God and I have been sent to speak to you and to tell you this good news. And now you will be silent, not able to speak until the day this happens, because you did not believe my words, which will come true at their proper time." Meanwhile, the people were waiting for Zechariah and wondering why he stayed so long in the temple. When he came out, he could not speak to them. They realized he had seen a vision in the temple, for he kept making signs to them, but remained unable to speak. When his time of service was completed, he returned home. After this, his wife Elizabeth became pregnant and for 5 months remained in seclusion. "The Lord has done this for me," she said. "In these days, he has shown his favor and taken away my disgrace among the people." Let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, we pray that you would pour out your Spirit in this place this evening. We believe you've already come among us. We've experienced you already. As the Word has been sung to us, as we have seen it made objective in this baptism. We pray, O Lord, that now by your Spirit you would fall on this word that has been read, and through the preaching of it, that you would cause it to go down deep into good soil and to bear much fruit, and that you would make us a people who believe. We pray it in Jesus' name and for his sake, and God's people said together, Amen. Often in our worship service, we sing hymns written by Horatius Bonar. Horatius Bonar's youngest brother was Andrew Bonar. He was a pastor in Scotland in the 1800s. Andrew Bonar was a prolific writer. He was most famous for his biography of Robert Murray McShane, another great Presbyterian minister. But even this man, who was so skilled in the preaching of God's word and writing of it, was helpless without the Holy Spirit. On occasion, he was called upon by one of his parishioners who had lost her husband to come and comfort her. He made a pastoral visit. The woman was beside herself in grief of untimely loss of her husband, and she was asking her pastor to speak words of comfort to her, and this brilliant man was sharing every passage of Scripture he knew. He was reading to her, he was praying with her, he was reasoning with her, counseling with her, but nothing he said could bring her any comfort. And finally, she looked above his shoulder, and she saw something on the wall, and she said, "That's it." Her countenance brightened, she calmed, she was comforted, and he thought, "I've done it. I have said something that's brought her comfort." She looked past him and she said, "That's what I needed." She pointed to the wall behind him. It was an excerpt from a passage of Scripture in Hebrews chapter 1, verse 11. That passage, that full passage, reads this way: "They will perish, but you remain. They will all wear out like a garment," speaking of the creation. That whole verse was not on her wall, just two words. He, you remaineth. You remaineth. You remain, though the heavens and the earth pass away, though they will perish someday. You, O God, you're the faithful one, and you will never pass away. You remain, no matter what. That, she said, is my comfort. In this hour of darkness, in my grief, in my mourning, though I don't understand why my husband has been taken away from me at this time, I know that whatever I don't understand, it is still you, You alone are trustworthy. I can put my faith in you. This morning in the morning service, we talked about the faith of a mustard seed. And the faith of a mustard seed, we said, is the mustard seed just doing what it is supposed to do. And faith in a Christian is that, doing what you are supposed to do. Faith is obedience. Obedience is faith. There is no distinction between the two in the Scriptures. To believe the Lord Jesus is to obey Him in every situation. To obey the Lord Jesus in every situation is put your faith at work when it makes sense and when it doesn't make sense. That's what Zechariah and Elizabeth illustrate to us, not because they are great, but because their Savior is great. Their Savior keeps them in the faith. Their Savior, the one who would come after their son, this Savior had been pursuing them through the long courses of history, had been pursuing them to keep them faithful even for this moment, and to keep them faithful even through their disappointment, and even when it was too good to be true, and even when they were disciplined for their lack of faith. Calls us to do the same. It calls us to put our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, regardless of what happens in this world, regardless of what happens in our political situation, regardless what happens in our health, regardless of what happens or doesn't happen, what we want to happen or it doesn't occur the way we want it to happen. He says, I am always worthy of your trust, and you must fulfill your purpose, the purpose for which I made you, which is to walk in faith with me throughout all the days of your life. An appropriate message for the close of this All Saints Day. I want you to notice the first point as it comes to us in verses 5-7, that we must believe even when we are disappointed. All suffering is ultimately disappointment. When you get a bad diagnosis, that's disappointing because you had another plan for your life. When you don't get a job, when you don't get chosen for the school that you want, when that relationship that you wanted doesn't succeed, when you don't meet your goals, when life doesn't turn out the way you want it to be, we may call that suffering, but we may also call that disappointment. And there is an opportunity for the devil to work faithlessness in us. Only the devil in his evil is creative enough to make cynicism and bitterness more attractive to us than believing in the faithfulness of the Lord Jesus Christ and the goodness of God. Only the devil in his evil is able to coax us into thinking it will be far better for you to remain cynical and disappointed and bitter for the rest of your life than to cast your life on Christ even in this disappointment. And that's exactly what the devil will do if you let him. Zechariah and Elizabeth did not. Who are these people? Let me introduce them to you. Let me show you how God would not allow cynicism and bitterness to make its way into their lives. God found Zechariah. God found Zechariah even though he could have been tempted to think that God had forgotten him. Let me tell you how he would have known that God found him. He was one of 8,000 priests in Israel. There are 8,000 priests in Israel, 24 divisions, roughly 300 each. He was of the 8th division of Abijah. Each division had 2 weeks a year they were responsible for. And those priests in that division only knew their responsibility by lot. That is, they sort of rolled the dice. And they would roll the dice. It was their 2 weeks coming up. The division of Abijah rolled the dice, and they said, Zechariah, such and such is your day. God found Zechariah on his day. He didn't appear to just any priest on that day. He found Zechariah. because Zechariah was one in whom he was going to demonstrate his power in weakness. Here was an old man and his wife. You notice he was a smart husband. He didn't say, "My wife is old." He said, "She's advanced in age." And here's Zechariah and Elizabeth, past childbearing age, and God said, "Now it's time." They've been praying all these years, all these decades, all these years for a child. And he's been praying as well as he would as a priest for the Savior to come. Now it's time. Nature would say that her womb is closed. It's impossible. And so God caused the lot to fall on Zechariah, and then God met him in the chamber. And think about Elizabeth. Elizabeth was a daughter of Aaron. She was a preacher's kid. And she was barren, we're told, and she experienced disgrace. Though God never said that a barren woman was disgraced, it was a common part of the worldview to say that a woman who couldn't have children was a disgrace. And there was some reason that that man and woman were not able to have a child. It must be because they had sinned in some way. That's not because God said that. It's because their culture had begun to think that. You know that from other parts of Scripture, like John 9, when the man born blind is brought to Jesus, and the people ask, "Who sinned, this man or his parents?" And Jesus said, "Neither." Now, it doesn't mean that they were sinless. It means that this man's blindness was not directly related to some sin. So Zechariah and Elizabeth, you can imagine, they're supposed to be leaders in the church of Israel, and yet some sin had kept them from having children. She was disgraced. God had demonstrated throughout redemptive history that he was merciful, and he remains merciful to women who cannot have children. To Sarah, to Hagar, to Leah, to Hannah, God showed himself especially merciful, and now to Elizabeth. And just in case the culture missed it, God says about them, they were blameless. They were righteous. They kept his commands. That the barrenness was not due to them some secret and repetitive sin. Now that word blameless is a curious one to us, because we might think then, now does this mean that they never sinned? Is this some kind of immaculate conception? And of course it's not. This is a word, this blameless word, is used by David a lot of times in the Psalms. It's used by the psalmist to describe themselves in distinction to the wicked. And we understand from putting the whole scripture together, we know the Bible says no one is righteous, no, not one, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. So no one is actually absolutely blameless. We know when the Bible says so-and-so is blameless, it means they are relatively blameless. David gives the best explanation of it in Psalm 19, when he says in verse 13, "Keep your servant from willful sins, so that sin will not rule over him. Then will I be blameless, innocent of the great transgression." It meant that the overall pattern of their life was one of faithfulness. Yes, they sinned, but they continued to repent. They came back to the hope of the Savior who was coming. They continued to seek him because the Spirit was living in them, making them faithful. Though they were disappointed, though they had every reason to be bitter against God, because after all the culture was scorning them and blaming them for their barrenness, we're told that they never quit looking faithfully at God. "You will fulfill your purposes. No matter what you're going through, brother or sister, no matter how you have been disappointed, no matter how life has not worked out for you, no matter what has been taken away from you, no matter what dream has not been realized, you must not allow the devil to get a foothold in your life, to cause a root of bitterness to grow up in you, as the writer of Hebrews says. You must do battle with that temptation to cynicism and bitterness, because Christ is faithful. God, who has promised to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob to bring a Savior, has not forsaken that promise. He has brought that Savior to you. And if He could do that through all of those opposition, all of those enemies that tried to arrest the progress of redemption, then how much more can you be assured that no matter how life doesn't seem to fit and work out the way you think it should, how much more can you trust that the Lord is directing your life exactly the way it should be? Because He loves you. Because He wants only what is best for you. And because He is righteous and does only good. You must believe. You must trust Him even when He disappoints you. And you must believe when He announces hope to you. Even now, as I've been saying those things, as I've been urging you to do battle with cynicism and bitterness and reminding you of the promises of God that have been realized throughout redemptive history, some of you are saying, that is just too good to be true. Well, you're in good company, because Zechariah thought it was too good to be true too. God knew that this would be hard news for Zechariah to hear, hard to believe. So He sent Gabriel, no second-class angel, one who was in the presence of God, one who was at the right hand of God, one who did battle with demons. Remember when He came to help Daniel? He said, I'm sorry, I'm a little bit late. I had to battle a few demons over nations before I got here. This is Gabriel. Gabriel is sent personally to announce what? Good news. Good news not only that they were going to have a baby, but this baby is actually going to introduce the Savior. Zechariah, you've been praying all of your life. Your forefathers have been praying for the coming of the Messiah. He's almost here. And your son is going to be named John. The name means God has been gracious. And Zechariah said, I'm not sure that's true. Now, Zechariah should have believed that for several reasons. For one, he knew God's power. He was an expert on God's power. He had related to the people and repeated hundreds of times the magnificent works of God in the Old Testament. He had told them the Exodus story time and time again. How could it be impossible for him to believe that if God could take the people of Israel out of Egypt, that it would be impossible for him to open the womb of his wife? But he didn't believe it. He should have believed it because he'd been praying for it. Remember the story of, if it's possible, even when you're praying and God supplies for you to say, no, that's not it. And you go back to praying. You know that happened in the New Testament. The church had been praying for Peter to be let out of prison. There's a knock at the door. They go and say, oh, Peter's here. That can't be Peter. Let's go back to praying for Peter. It's just the way we are. We look squarely at the power of God as it's revealed in the Bible. We can know it in our past lives. But this is different. This is more powerful than even God, we think. And I've been praying about it. This can't be the answer. He should have known it when Gabriel himself showed up. Apparently, angels can have emotion. Because Gabriel, in verse 19, is miffed. He says, how can this be? I'm an old man. My wife is well along in years. I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God. I've been sent to speak to you and to tell you good news. You won't say another word until he's born. You can't hear either. Now, God sometimes, when we refuse to believe, God is always patient with us. We made that point this morning. He doesn't treat us like a mustard seed. You're not going to believe, so I'm going to get another mustard seed. He reasons with us. He endures with us. He pulls us to himself. But he's not indulgent. There are times when God must discipline us. He must teach us a lesson. Zechariah, you should have believed me. And Zechariah, I am not going to tolerate you proselytizing unbelief among my people until that baby is born. So I'm going to shut your mouth. Sometimes God has to remove us from places of influence. Sometimes God has to take us away from privilege. Sometimes God has to discipline us. Sometimes grace is tough. Sometimes love can be severe in its mercy because you or I need a lesson. He loves us too much to let us continue to go forward in that sin. And he's not going to let it spread like an infection, like a disease among the people of God. So he arrests it for a season. Some of you may be in that season. You notice, though, that Zechariah doesn't complain. Zechariah doesn't go to the priest union and say, I've been treated unfairly. I've been misunderstood. He doesn't complain against God. He doesn't sit down and pout. Woe is me, I've been so mistreated. God said he's a gracious God, but here I've been removed from service. I can't talk, I can't even hear. It's humiliating. What does Zechariah do? Zechariah continues to believe, even while he's disciplined. You see in verses 23 to 25, what does he do? He finishes his work. God strikes him mute, strikes him deaf. And Zechariah thinks in his heart, I've learned a lesson. I need to go back to my work. This doesn't make sense to me. I don't know how this is all going to work out, but I do know that my responsibility in this life situation, in this place where I am present, is to be faithful. And so I have a job to do. I'm going to keep burning my incense, keep doing my priestly work. I'm going to finish the job. Apparently, he also shared the news with Elizabeth. Now, the only way he could have done it was by writing a note. Can you imagine that note left on the breakfast table? You're going to have a baby. You're going to name him John. He's going to be the forerunner of the Messiah. I can't talk. I can't even hear if you ask me questions. It's just got to wait. You're going to have to wait until the day comes. It's a lesson for us. To believe is to be obedient. To be obedient is to believe. To believe even when you are disappointed, even when you are when it's too good to be true, even when you are being disciplined, to believe is to put the next foot in front of the other. It is to go back to church. It is to go back to your job. It is to go back to your relationship. It is to go on with the next step and let God make sense of it. You aren't supposed to sit and pout until he makes it clear. Go back to what he's called you to do. Jesus would be asked in another gospel, John chapter 6. After he had fed the 5,000, he went to the other side of the lake in John chapter 5. And then John chapter 6, the people have to run around to the other side of the lake. Somehow Jesus made it over there. And when they came around, they said, we've been looking everywhere for you. We want to follow you. He said, you only want to follow me because you want bread. No. We want to do the works of God. How do we do the works of God? And Jesus said, there is only one work to do. The work of my Father is to believe in the one whom he sent. There is only one command to keep. And if you keep that command, all of the other commands flow from it. The one command is to believe on the Lord Jesus. It is to put your trust completely in the Lord Jesus. And when you put your faith, your trust completely in the Lord Jesus, He works obedience through you in response to His grace. That lesson had to be learned in a dramatic way. I've told you before, it had to be learned in a dramatic way by another Scottish preacher named Thomas Chalmers, who had preached only to his people. He wasn't even a Christian as he was preaching, and his people kept coming to church and kept praying for their preacher to be saved. And the way the Lord decided to bring him to himself was to make him sick. He was bedridden. He had been preaching to his people that the way that they could please the Lord was to do good work. They had to do good works. They had to reform themselves. They had to be involved in society and so forth. And then suddenly he is bedridden. He couldn't do any of the things that he'd been telling his people to do. And he realized in reading the book of Acts, there was only one thing he could do while he was flat on his back. It was to believe on the Lord Jesus. Believe on the Lord Jesus and you will be saved. Not just initially, but through the whole of your life. He said that command, that is the one command that includes all of the rest. I've been preaching all the rest to my people. They can't keep any of those commands in and of themselves any more than I can on my back. I must believe in the Lord Jesus. I have a friend who called me last week. He's the strongest person, emotionally speaking, he is the strongest person I know. He's led me through lots of personal difficulties. We've worked together. He's not a minister, but he is a professional people helper. Strongest person emotionally I know. And he called me and he said, I am terrified. Of what? I don't know. I'm full of anxiety. I'm depressed. I can't get out of bed. I can't sleep. I am fearful of everything. I know I've helped hundreds of people through the same thing, but none of those things help me. And I have even believed this week, things have become so dark for me, he said, my faith has been non-existent. I don't mean that he said that it's been flat. I don't mean that it's been less than stellar. I don't mean that it's just been faltering. I mean there has been no faith whatsoever. Emotionally, I have no conviction that there is a God, that there is a Christ. And this week he said, my faith has only been declarative. All I have been able to do is to say, I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and is Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. All I could do was say that. My faith has only been declarative. I called him just a couple of days ago. He said, God is leading me out. God never forsook me. God led me, is leading me out. The most encouraging thing to him through that dark, those dark weeks of the soul, not just the dark night of the soul, was that when he could not profess Christ, Christ was professing himself in him. You must, you can, you shall believe, even when you're disappointed. Even when it's too good to be true. Even while you're being disciplined. Because Christ is your Savior. If He's not, make this the night. If He is not your Savior, here is the one thing you can do. Believe on the Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus, come into my life. Take it over. Unite my life to yours and create faith in me that is absent of my own resources. Believe. It's the one command that includes all the others. Let's pray together. Well, Lord Jesus, we say to you, we believe, but help our unbelief. We pray, Lord God, that faith would be your lasso to capture us and draw us very tightly to yourself, wherever we are. If we're away from you in complete unbelief, lasso us and bring us to conversion. If we're wandering in rebellion, please bring us back. If we're anxious and afraid, please hold us very tightly. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Stand together and sing this one.
Holy, holy, holy.
For his blessing, may God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit dismiss you with his power and peace. Amen.